In this video, I'll be going over Elvia Giants. I'll talk about buffs, tips and tricks, rotation, spot mechanics. I'll give an explanation on drops, and I'll tell you what you should expect. So first of all, let's talk about knowledge. First, I would recommend you get S knowledge on all of the mobs in the spot before going to Grinder if you don't have S knowledge on them already. Now, it's a lot easier to get S knowledge on mobs from Balenos all the way to Medea, so I would suggest you go there off of Elvia and try get S knowledge on every single one of them. It should only take a few minutes. Another thing, if you think you are gonna grind there for a long time, I suggest you level up the node up to 20 for increased drop rate. Now, the node, as you can see, it looks like it would be Gehaku Plain, but it's actually Primal Giant Post, and I'll explain why. If you go to Monster Zone Info, Elvia Realm, and you click on Primal Giant Post, if you look here, it says, it should say like 0% or 0.5%. If you put your mouse on it, it tells you the connected node. Now, this is the node you should be leveling in order to get increased drop rate. So according to PA, Primal Giant Post is the node for this spot. As you can see, I went bald trying to make this video for you guys, so it would really help regrow my hair if you left a like and a subscribe on the video. Now let's talk about buffs. First of all, the buffs I'm gonna be presenting is if you are capped at the spot. Now how would you know? If you go to Monster Zone Info, you press on Elvia, you go to Primal Giant Post, and you click View Total Stats, it'll show up like this. If you are awakening, the second number right here, 814, is your number. If you are a succession, 812 is your number. And if this number is as close as possible to the 856 restricted, or it's past this point when fully buffed, then you are capped at this spot. Now, this number is not a fully representative of your actual damage. If you want a better representation, you need to check it out on garmo.com. This is a good indicator if you don't want to use that. So first of all, we're gonna get the church buff. Wrong! We don't use church buff. We're past the AP cap, so basically we don't make use of the AP and accuracy from the church buff, and we don't need the defense buff because mobs won't kill us in giants. Now the next thing we're gonna use is villa buff. If you go to your tent, if you have a tent, you can just go to villa, scroll over here, and you just pick villa body enhancement for however much you're gonna grind there. It's from 1 hour up to like 5 hours. Now, if you don't have Book of Old Moon, you will not be able to get this buff remotely. However, if you go all the way and you get the villa invitation, like I have here, you can get this buff. And here's proof, Secret Book of Old Moon is not active. I have a villa invitation. If I try to get 1 hour, bam, we got 1 hour of villa. So you can do this instead. Now, if you don't wanna do this, I don't think it's really worth getting this one because it doesn't really give you anything if you're past the cap. 10 monster AP means nothing if it's 5% restricted. Now, as for food buffs, you are gonna be using Exquisite Cron Meal if you're capped. You will also use Spirit Perfume Elixir for perfumes. As for Elixir, we're gonna be using Elixir of Indignation as opposed to the Elixir Rotation because, from my experience, it's better, and Garmot also says it's like 3% better, so there you go. Now, for those of you that want to know more about elixirs and food buffs and perfumes and so on, I have made a video about it, which I will be linking down below. Also, for those of you that are impatient and wanna know more, I've also made an Excel spreadsheet, which I will also be linking down below, which shows you every single spot in the game that matters and every single AP bracket you might be in, and also have like the optimal buffs you need to use at that specific AP. So if you are not above the cap, you can check what you should be using down below in the Excel sheet, or you can watch the video for an explanation. As for location-based quests, I would say they aren't worth it. Let me explain. So the only thing you get from those quests is Powder of Nightmare. The only two things you can get with Powder of Nightmare is Corrupted Breath and Scorching Sun Shard. Now, this is Corrupted Breath. Use it in order to empower like certain draughts, like for example Elixir of Frenzy. You get it up by 5 monster AP, but you get a shit ton of those dropped in the spot anyway. And same for like the second thing, Scorching Sun Shard, which you also get a ton of when you just grind in the spot. So what I would recommend is just not bother with it, because Corrupted Bread is super cheap and you get a shit ton of them, and Scorching Sun Shard is a good price, but it won't sell, because as you can see, there's like 53,000 of them for sale right now, and I have some for sale for at least a week now and they haven't sold yet. So it's up to you if you really want extra. But if you do want to do those quests, you just go to Monster Zone Info, Elvia Realm, Primal Gen Post, and then you can see the reoccurring quests here. You just right click on them and it just sends you to the right NPC. You need to be on Elvia in order to see the NPCs and the quests most of the times, if not all. And you get the quests from here and you just go grind, and in about 1 hour you should have all of them done, and you will be getting a bunch of Powder of Nightmare in exchange. Now, another thing you can do is request guild buffs. Like, guild buffs give you 10% item drop rate, 100% combat EXP, and you also can request the knowledge buffs with like increased knowledge gain chance and also increase like higher grade knowledge chance. Now, this will really help you when you're grinding for the knowledge before starting your actual grind there, if you don't have S knowledge on all of the mobs there. Now, some of you veterans might have a Crocodile gear set on your horse, and you might be tempted to use the buff from the horse with 5%, like with 5 AP extra, but actually, if you are capped, that buff is also useless, so I'd say don't bother with it. Now, obviously, you would want to use your item collection increase scroll at level 2 at all times, and you don't use Agris here. Also, if you have any sort of EXP increase scrolls, you would love to use it here, because it gets like quite a lot of EXP from the mobs, so it's really good to use those here. Now, for those of you that want to min-max, you also have furniture buff with 9 extra human damage. You can use the Breath Imbued stuff versus Boarhead for extra 9 human for 5 hours. There's also lesser versions of this. Another example would be this one for 9 damage for 3 hours. You might also have like one for 6 extra human damage for 5 hours. And you can also get the Master Stuff's Frost Wolf for 9 damage for 1 hour, if you'd like. Also, if you have good gear, you could also use a Pen Celeth Crescent Pendulum for a main weapon. It doesn't need to be like, it doesn't matter if you're Awakening or Succession, as long as you're past the cap when you switch the weapons, the Celeth will give you more damage in human spots. As you can see, it gives you 35 human damage and like extra AP against monsters, and you can also make an ultimate version of this weapon, making it a yellow weapon, which will give it a little bit of extra AP. I think it'll be something like 120 AP, and if you are still past the cap, you get more use of the human damage on the Celeth weapon than on the Black Star weapon. Also, the loss on accuracy doesn't really change a lot in the giant spot. Also, you would like to not forget about your alchemy stone. You want to activate this. And now about the artifact combo, you would like to have something like this. It's called the Wild Humans. You need 2 Marsh Artifact extra AP against monsters, in which you will add 2 Blight Lightstone of Fire, and you get another Blight Lightstone of Fire and an Iridescent Lightstone in the other one. In total, you'll get some 24 extra human damage. You can also use the same combo with Kabuas, but I don't think it does anything to this human spot and specifically, because the mobs pretty much won't kill you. So yeah, that's why I think it's better to just go with the Marsh Artifact here. And if you have Kabuas, it doesn't matter, you can use those. Now let's talk about Crystal Page. This is the best in slot Crystal Page for the spot. You'll be using Visionary Crystal of Elkarl, Rebellious Spirit Crystal, Red Spirit Crystal, Corrupted Magic Crystal, 2 of them, 2 Olukas, Glorious Crystal of Gallantry. You also will use Glorious Crystal of Gallantry Akrad. You will use 2 Red Battlefield Crystals Viper, Red Battlefield Crystals Addis, 2 of them as well, Crystal of Brutal Decimation, 2 of them. If you can, Ancient Spirit Crystal Swiftness, even though this is pretty much pay to win. And obviously Gear and Steer. Now last thing, if you're Awakening Lahn, those are the skill add-ons that I use here. I think they do very well, so I'm not sure. There might be better, but this is what I use. On to spot mechanics. Okay, so where do you need to go? First of all, if you press M and you go to Gehaku Plane node, which is right nearby Keplin, or it's somewhere around like south east of Calpheon, right here. If you right click the node, it's gonna send you to the node manager. Now, once you get close to the node manager, you gotta notice the node manager is somewhere up there on that rock. Now, the only way to climb this rock is by going through this. Now, you don't want to climb the rock at all. You don't care about that. You just want to make sure we're in the right spot. So, as you come to this spot right here, you just want to turn around and you just go in a straight line till you see this rock over here, and right behind it you can park your horse. See, like right there is the big rock with the NPC, and here is where you park the horse. Also, in this spot right here, you can pretty much put your camping tool. You can prepare your villa scroll, you can just repair your items, and then you can just start grinding. Okay, so now, before I explain to you the mechanics and the rotation of the spot, I just want to mention that I have made a video where I cover in great detail how PvE works. In this video, I talk about PvE screen indicators, positioning, Awakening Lahn skill rotation, add-ons, and much more. So if you want to check it out, it's gonna be in the links down below. Now, once you have your camp tool down and your horse park here, we can just go straight into Elvia with this button right here to the left of the minimap. Now, as you can see, we are on Elvia, and here is our horse, completely safe, nothing's around to harm it. Now, I'll go on and show you my rotation, and I'll explain it for different, like 3 different levels of clear speed. First of all, we're gonna start straight off from the horse. Straight ahead, you have this pack over here. You just gotta kill this pack over here, and then as soon as you're done with it, you gotta move on to the left side, and there's this pack right here. Now you're gonna kill this pack over here as well, and then we're gonna move on to this pack right here, which is around this rock. You're gonna kill this one. Right now, I'm just going slowly to show you the rotation, okay? Just pay attention. Now, this one to the left side of the rock. See the rock over there? We got this pack right here. We're gonna kill it. That's it. Now, you got this pack over here, which is near this camp. We kill this one. We go around. We follow the wall over there to the next pack. Now, we kill this one as well. We just... Just want to make sure they gather up together so you can actually kill them better. Same with those guys. You come here, you can just gather them up together, and then you can just hit them all with your spells. Now here, you just got this pack. This is the last pack near the wall. You just kill this one, and we're gonna start making our way back. Now this is the short rotation. We're just gonna kill this pack over here. Now this pack is gonna be on this path here, like right in front where we have the NPC, right? The NPC is up there for the Gihaku plane node. And we killed this pack over here, and now we're making our way back. We're gonna go over those rocks, and you see this red thing over here? You go to the pack like right next to it. You gotta kill this pack over here, and then you gotta move to the left and kill this pack over here. This is pretty much it. This is the last pack you're gonna kill, and now we're back where we started. That's where the horse is. This is the first rotation. Now this is a rotation for those that are like super slow. Most people will over clear this rotation. Now if the first rotation is not respawning fast enough for your clear speed, this is the second one. Now I'm gonna go through this one faster because this one is kind of similar to the other one, is just slightly longer. So you're just gonna go on, you're gonna clean this part here, then this one over here, just like in the last rotation. The guys at the rock here, the guys on the left here, the guys at the camp again. You're just gonna go around, follow the wall, kill the guys over here. Here is the last pack to the wall, and then right here to the left we're gonna have this pack over here with the NPC, right? There we go. Then we're gonna go over those stones over here, the pack right next to this red thing over here, which we're gonna talk about later. And now we would be back to where we started. But if you're clearing too fast, then the first pack didn't respawn yet, right? So you'd have nothing over there. So what do you do? You're gonna go all the way here, you're gonna kill this pack. You can go over here, kill this pack. You can kill this pack over here as well. You can go to the pack to the left of this red thingy over here as well. It's like a portal, or they call it a rift. Now the pack to the right of the rift, we kill this one as well. Then you just want to go straight up here, and this is the last pack. So that's how you do it. Now this would be the first pack again, and the rotation is done. Now if somehow you're faster than this, then there is the third rotation you can do. Now the third rotation would go something like this. First of all, you just go on and kill the pack over here to your right side, like that's where the horse is. You go to the right, you just kill this one over here. Then we're gonna go straight to the one over here where the rift is. You kill this one, and then you go past to the other one near the rift. You kill it, awesome. Then you go straight forward, you kill this one. And then to the right of this one, you'll have just another one. You kill this one as well. Now there's gonna be this pack over here. You wanna kill this. Now that you've killed this pack over here, what you wanna do is now, instead of going that way, you're just gonna go here to the right, kill this pack over here. Once you kill this pack over here, you're gonna go to the pack that's right in front of the path to the NPC. You're just gonna kill this pack here as well. You're just gonna go forward, kill this pack. Obviously, you got it, bam. You're gonna go to this one that is right near the wall. You kill it perfectly. Now, once this one's killed, you just follow the wall like usual. You kill every single one of the mobs around here. You kill the mobs near this pack over here. You just go ahead, you kill the ones at the camp. You go around, you kill those guys in the corner here. Now we gotta meet the rock guys again, just sitting over here. You gotta kill them as well. And now here you can just kill this pack right here. And then you're just gonna go straight to this one. You're gonna kill this one as well. You're gonna be back to this pack over here. This is the last pack. You're gonna kill everything around here, and then you're back to the horse, and then just start again to the right side over there. Okay, so one thing that I want to explain is that the third one is really long. Pretty much 99% of all people won't ever need to do such a long rotation here. But if you do happen to be that good and you need all of that, then just be cautious, because somewhere around here, okay, so this, you got this over here, like this pack, like close to the stone, this one, and the one that's right in front of the pathway here, are generally also part of another rotation. So if somebody else is grinding this other rotation with you, you're just gonna be stealing their mobs. So if there's a guy over there grinding that spot over there, there's probably one right now. Look, you see him right there. He's gonna want the packs here and the packs there. So pretty much you're kind of like nerfing his rotation. So be cautious about that. Ideally, the second rotation is the best you can have, because as you can see, there's a rift to the left and a rift to the right. Now, if you kill mobs in a rotation which covers both zones in which rift 1 and rift 2, you have a higher chance of proccing an event which is specific to all Kalfion Elvia spots. Now, this event will be spawning 3 different bosses which you will be able to kill in order to get loot, and you will also get a chance at a Disto earring. If you kill mobs in both of the zones, you basically increase your chance for a boss, which in exchange increases your overall chance for a Disto that hour. So it's good if you are super fast, it's good to just kill in both zones. You also get a buff after killing the boss that's gonna spawn through the rift, and basically that buff will just make you incredibly strong here. The buff is similar to the Elvia Serendia spots buff, however this one only is given to you if you defeat the boss from the rift, and it only lasts 5 minutes, and it has a cooldown of like I believe 30 minutes, so I think you can only have the buff twice an hour. Now let's talk about spot mechanics. As you're gonna be killing around the in the spot, you will notice that at some point the spot will have like this purple circle around the mobs. Now this purple circle, as you walk in, is gonna spawn some sort of a soul in the middle. Now you see that red thingy? Now what's going on here is that there's gonna be mobs spawning continuously, and they will be just gathering around this like soul thingy over here. It looks like a purple, reddish, really depends on. As you keep killing them, more mobs will just respawn here. As you can see, they just start respawning and they attack that over there. Now they won't break it or anything. You can literally take your time with them. You can just leave them and just go around and do your rotation and just kill them when you get back here. But basically they just keep spawning and the mobs get stronger. Like you can see, now we have bigger, better giant mobs. This is already the third spawn. And after a few spawns, you get an elite spawn. The elite I was talking about is right here, the giant fighter. As you can see, it says powerful on top of his name, and he's stronger than the rest of them. Now, two things I want to talk to you about here. First of all, it's worth to use Agris Fever when you kill it. If you use Agris Fever, you're gonna get the extra trash loot every single time you kill him, and it's gonna be a good amount, and it'll add up throughout the hour. Now, once you're done killing all of the group of mobs around here, this guy is gonna be spawning. And if you kill him, there's a chance he will spawn another elite called Gehaku. Now let's see if this one's gonna spawn it. Well, it seems like he didn't. Now, one very important tip is when you see this purple circle going around, once you gotta get in and the mobs start spawning, instead of just sitting around waiting for the mobs to spawn, what I recommend instead is just going around and trying to kill other mob groups as much as possible while the mobs are spawning. So now I just kill the mobs, they're spawning. I'm just going to the next. Just killing this group here first. We're just getting through it. And then the mobs have spawned. I'm just going back here. I'm killing the mobs that just spawned. Once the mobs that just spawned have died, we just go to another group right here. We kill this one. Once this group is dead, we're just gonna go back to where the mob spawned again. I just bounce back and forth between that group where the mobs are just gonna spawn and other groups of mobs around you. That way, you're just not wasting any time waiting for the mobs, and you just maximize your silver right here. It's important when you do that to maximize your silver, you need to make sure you have groups of mobs around you. If not, just keep going with your grind and just you'll be back there at some point and you're gonna kill the mobs. And if you got mobs around, make sure to not kill the mobs that are ahead in the direction you would go with your rotation, because then you'll have cooldown by just having to walk longer to the next pack. So always try to go off-road or behind for the mobs, and if you can't, just kill the spot, kill the mobs on the spot right there and just move on. Now, one thing to note is that if you use Aggress on the Elite, you need to always remember to turn it on and off after you kill it. You don't want to use Aggress here. This spot is very, very bad with Aggress. Once you kill the Elite, you will also get Soul's Gratitude, which gives you attack speed and cast speed for 15%. This is gonna last for 1 minute and it's gonna be quite a decent buff for some classes. Okay, so this is one of the first bosses that spawn here. This is the Ogre. When the boss spawns out of the rift, you will see this like red circle around the area blocking your view. Now, one thing to notice is that this guy is gonna come straight for you, so you don't really have to go after him. A good idea would be for you to just grind and mind your own business, and when he gets close, you just start hitting him every now and then. But don't start focusing on him too much. His HP is pretty big and like the damage you deal is not great. So I suggest just walk around, kill the mobs, guy will follow, and you just kill him slowly as you're going at it. Here's a tip. When the boss spawns, it takes 5 minutes for the boss to despawn. So if your debuff is on less than 5 minutes, then you can wait the cooldown out while killing mobs, and then you can kill the boss so you can get the buff again. Now the same with the Elite, you might want to start up your Aggress as soon as he's gonna die for some extra trash loot. One thing, this guy will also deal a lot of damage, so unless you're like high DP, this guy can really hurt, so watch out for that. Now just go around, kill the mobs, wait for him to get close, make sure you dodge him. See, he'll do red areas like that, so it's pretty easy to dodge the big attacks. He's gonna glow up like that when he's gonna attack. He's pretty slow. Just make sure you go behind him and hit him with back attacks so he can kill him faster. And yeah, that's pretty much it with the boss spawns. The other two will just do literally the same thing. Basically, the hardest one would be the Cyclops, because he just has better moveset compared to the Orc. There we go, we killed him. The red sky disappeared, and now we just got a 5-minute buff. It's called Corrupted Darkness. Now you will see that I just killed the mobs instantly with this buff without having any trouble. Like here, for example, they just died, just like I would kill orcs with the weapon buff, right? Like they're pretty tough, but when you have this on, they just like die instantly. And you can also notice there's a half an hour cooldown. You cannot get it again for another 30 minutes. So even if you do get another boss this hour, you will not get the buff again if you already have it. Also, rotation 2 and 3 are especially good when you have the buff like this, because you kill mobs like at least 2 times faster, so you might just run into like problems holding the first rotation. As a small tip, you should also try your best to remember to hit the Z buff or use a 100% skill if you have a decent one in order to just keep track of your Z buff. The more you have your Z buff on, the better it is. It's the same thing for your E buff or Q buff, whatever your character has. Lahn has Shift E and you also get like a bunch of stuff from it, like AP, attack speed, movement speed, and all resistance. In this case, we want the attack speed and movement speed since we're capped here. Okay, so a few more tips for the spot is like, first of all, you want to make sure you hit the mobs from the back as much as you can. Now, the mobs here move quite fast as opposed to spots that are like bigger mobs and slower mobs like Tunkuta spot or like Olun's, but you can still get a few back attacks on them, especially when you first engage with the pack, so make sure you do that. Also, you want to make sure you position yourself and then you also hit your spells in such a way to hit as many of them as possible. If you can, sometimes you might have to wait half a second for them to position in order to just kill them all at the same time, so you don't have to spend that extra 1 or 2 seconds later just to actually kill another half of the pack later on. It's also important that if you damage the entire group and there's 1 or 2 mobs waiting behind like this guy here, if you can kill him in one shot, do it like this and then move on. However, if he's full HP, don't focus on killing him, just move on to the next pack. It's not worth using 2, maybe even 3 skills to just kill one mob when you can just like take half a second to the next group and just kill like 5 or 6 mobs with the same 2 skills. Just make sure you just leave it behind. I know it's tempting for some of you to just like sit there and attack that one dude, but it's not worth it. And also, sometimes if you move on, the mob might even follow you and you can kill it with the next pack, since mobs here actually do follow you quite a bit. So make sure you check it out and just leave him behind, and if you can, just kill him with the next pack. Now here we have another one of the bosses. Now this one is called Gigagord. Now this is the second boss of the group. Earlier we had Ogre, now this Gigagord will work a little bit different. Now as opposed to Ogre, this one spawns some little trash mobs as it's like spawning from the rift, and those little mobs just give you extra trash loot from the rift. Also, one thing to notice that trash loot from the rift is quite different from the other trash loot, like it's this blue tattered shadow one. Now you can get you can also, if you want, since it's a bit more expensive, you can use Aggress on those mobs and just also Aggress on the boss as you're gonna kill him, but just make sure you don't spend too much Aggress here. It's not really that much worth it. Personally, I would say just use it on the boss, but you can use it on the little ones as well. Now this is Gigagord. He also deals quite a good amount of damage, however not as much as the other two, and he's also like a little bit faster than the other two, so I guess that's why his damage is a little bit lower. Just make sure you stand behind him, use your Aggress before the kill, and just that's pretty much it. I mean, I guess there's nothing much more to him. There we go, we killed him as well. Unfortunately, neither did the Ogre or Gigagord give us the Disto Earring, so I guess that was unfortunate. We also didn't get the buff again because we are 8 minutes on the punishment from getting the other buff. I mean, I would say it's a punishment because we can't get the buff for half an hour. Basically, for half an hour, you just can't get another buff, and we didn't. Okay, so we were fortunate enough to get a Gehaku spawn. Now, this is the second elite. If you kill the first guy, like I said, you have a chance of getting this dude. Also, mind-fuckingly hilarious, we also got a boss spawn again. Now, for Gehaku, he's a little bit stronger than the other elite. You want to kill him just the same way, just go ham, kill him. Use up your Agris as soon as you are about to kill him for extra drop. And that's pretty much it. He doesn't do anything too crazy. Now, obviously, we just got another Gigagord drop here, which is like insane, because this is the third boss we got this hour. Now, this was a crazy hour. Also, unfortunately, still no distro drop out of like three bosses in 1 hour, which is crazy unlucky. Okay, so now let's talk a little bit about thrash loot and everything you can get here. So if we go to Monster Zone Info, Elvia Realm, Primal Giant Post, you can see here everything you can drop from the spot. Now I'll go through every single one of them and just briefly tell you a little bit about them. So first of all, we got Trace of Nature. Trace of Nature is a very useful item for alchemy. There's quite a few recipes that use this. You might need this for certain crystals or anything like that. What I suggest is either keep a little bit of it in your one of your storages, or just sell it and buy it when you need it. But there might be a chance that you won't find any for sale, because people buy the shit a lot. Now, next thing on the list, we got Scornful Spear. This is the trash loot at the spot. Now, this is basically your liquid silver from the spot. Every single mob you kill will give you a certain amount of Scornful Spear. Now, you gotta get anywhere between 15,000 up to like 30, 40,000, depending on how fast you are here. And pretty much that's how much money you gotta make. We got Tattered Shadow, which is pretty much the trash loot you're gonna get from every Rift boss spawn. And from Gigagord's minions. Now this is, while as Scornful Spear, you're gonna sell both to an NPC. You gotta get Crystallized Despair. Now Crystallized Despair might look crazy. You're like, oh my god, it's 22 million. And let's see, this hour I got 14 of them. So basically I just got like, what, almost 300 million out of this? Well, not quite. Those are pretty much full on the market, and the chances of you selling those are like very small, because there's a shit ton of people selling but only a few people buying. Now what's this for? This is basically for increasing your Vel's Heart level. You got like two extra levels, Blessed and Exalted, and as you do that, it just gives you a little bit more DP and stuff. Now, if you want to have a chance at getting any sort of money from those, what I recommend is just keep all of them, put them in a storage, and when you have like either 100 or 200 of them, just make either the Blessed Soul or the Exalted Soul. Like that, you might get a chance at selling those, because people will buy them to increase their value. Now, we got Corrupted Breath. Corrupted Breath, you gonna get a shit ton of. Like, we got 35 this hour. Out of those 35, you won't sell any, because there's like millions of them for sale. At least everything I'm talking about, like based on like how sold out they are or not, it's all based on EU market, okay? I don't know what's going on other servers, but on EU, there's a shit ton of those on the market. Same for a Crystallized Despair and so on. Corrupted Breath, you might just wanna keep them and just put them somewhere in a corner of a, like a distant storage, you know, Land of the Morning Light. And then we just might use them at some point. If you combine one of those with a Frenzy Drought, it's gonna just make a Corrupted Frenzy Drought, which gives you extra 5 monster damage, which will help you min-max for spots where you're not capped, such as Ulukita spots, which require a huge amount of AP, like 1,100 to get capped. Then you have Scorching Sun Shard. Now, as well as the other ones, Scorching Sun Shard might sell, but most likely won't. So what I recommend is just like try your luck selling them, or either that or keep them, or just try to, I don't even know what else you can do with those, to be fair. I didn't really look into it, if like Scorching Sun Crystal or anything like that might be of use. But basically you can try selling them. I did have luck selling them before. I've sold like 30 of them in one batch. Like I just left them and at one point overnight they just sold. But there's a lot of them on sale, so there's a low chance you're gonna sell them quick. Now, again, we got Massive Pure Magic. Massive Pure Magic, you're just gonna hold on to them as many as possible. You need them to create the stones which you use to upgrade your Black Stars, your Fallen Gods, and so on. So you will need Massive Pure Magic. Now, at some point, you'll have more than you'll ever need, but there's nothing much you can do with it. Maybe every time you get like 1,000 of it, you can just start, I don't know, selling it, and then you might get something like 50 mil or something out of it, which is not too bad. And then everything past 1,000, you just keep until you make another 1,000. Crystals, sealed black magic crystal, you just keep a few of them. You will need a lot of magical shards for a lot of shit in this game. Everything requires at least a few magical shards. So you will need to heat and melt those up. So I would say keep at least 200 of those. At least 200. I had 200 and then I just needed to use like 200 of those immediately after. So a lot of magical shards are needed. So just keep like 200, sell everything past that, and just try to keep a balance. Either that or you could just sell them and buy them later. It's up to you. What I do is I keep them. Now, Blessed Soul Fragment, we talked about earlier, you can make it with Crystallized Despair. You can also drop the entire piece. Obviously, it's awesome if you drop the entire piece, you can go and sell it. 4.3 bill, it might sell and you get a good chunk of your money. Nothing much to be said here. Blackstone, you should be saving at least about like 2,000 of those just in case for any sort of situations where you might need it. They aren't a lot of money, but like, who knows, maybe there's times when you won't find any for sale. Maybe there's times when you'll need them and you won't have the silver and you just remind yourself, oh shit, I have some of them saved. So just maybe save a few of them and then sell every other piece you get from now on. Then Black Distortion Earring is also another thing you can drop here. Again, we had like three bosses. I didn't drop any, but technically you should be dropping at least one every like two, three bosses. Usually you drop like one, if you're lucky, two bosses per hour. Three bosses was extremely lucky. Obviously, this is gonna add up to your silver. You can sell it, you can use it, you can do whatever you want with it. It's 300 mil, so that's a good chunk of money extra to your base silver from every other item. And now Ancient Spirit Light is the last thing we're gonna talk about. Basically, as you're grinding, you will drop this at some point. You need to look out in your inventory for it. What this does is the same way when the boss spawns and there's like a red arena that has the boss spawn in the middle, when you pop this, there's gonna be a yellow arena with, it'll have like yellow walls, and basically in that area you will get a 1 minute buff which will give you pretty much the same benefits as the buff that you get after you kill the boss. It will be for 1 minute. You can literally destroy every single mob with this buff as long as you have it on. In order to get the 1 minute buff, you need to be inside of the arena that is like with yellow walls. But once you got the buff, you can leave the arena and kill mobs outside of it. And once you run out of the buff after 1 minute, You can just go back inside the arena, which will still be up, and you can just get it again. Now you can repeat this for what I believe is like about 5 minutes as well. So technically you have like an extra 5 minutes of buff. The damage is similar again to the Elvia Serendia weapon buff, so you're gonna kill most things in like one shot once you have this on. And this one does not have a cooldown like the buff from the boss does. So this one, if you get a lot of them in 1 hour, you're lucky. You just use them every 5 minutes and you have the extra damage, so they're pretty good. Now, what you should be expecting here? Basically, it really depends on how min-maxed you are here, what your class is, and so on. So, your silver will differ here based on a lot of things. For example, if you have like an entire crystal page with human damage like I do, if you're gonna use, obviously, like... furniture buff that gives you human damage, if you have a Celeth 10 main weapon which gives you like extra, I don't even know, like 35 human damage or more, that those things will make a huge change here. Also, you need to be capped and so on, so obviously you gotta get anywhere between like 15-20k trash up to like 40,000 trash here. But like, even with the maximum amount of thrash, this place in my opinion is still weaker than orcs because of the stuff that you can't really sell, or it takes a long time to sell, so you won't really make a lot of money unless you do like at least like 20 hours here. As I explained, with the crystallized despair, you just need to get either 100 or 200 of them to create the exalted soul fragment of blessed sword fragment, which will take you a while. The crystallized despair won't sell, at least on EU it won't, and same with scorching sun shard, it just might not sell. So you might have like 100 of them, but you can get your money off of them. So yeah, basically I would say this is not a great spot. If you're min-max like to the like very absolute cap of damage you could possibly deal here, and if you're with an extremely powerful like top class in PvE, say like Awakening Nova or something, you might make somewhere between 800 and 1 bill. I'd say it's still better to just go orcs and get more, because orcs has a lot of drops that don't depend on the central market, so you just get like the seeds and the Valtara flames and such, which you can just sell to an NPC and you get your money from those. If you found the video helpful, maybe you want to leave a like, maybe subscribe, ring the bell to get your notifications if you want to see more, and if you got any questions, leave them in the comment section below, and I'll see you guys on the next one. Bye-bye.